Peter, what did your appointment to Princeton permit you to do which you couldn't do in Melbourne?
Well, for one thing, it gave me a platform in the United States. The United States is really very respectful of people at its elite universities, Harvard, Princeton and Yale. If you have a chair there, you're more likely to get invited to write articles for the New York Times, for example, which are seen then by many millions of readers. Whatever you say is likely to be, you know, given greater coverage, maybe even given greater weight. Because you have that position, you know, this may not be a good thing in itself, but since it exists, I feel that I have a duty to use it to try and get the kind of viewpoints that I think are important for Americans to listen to try and get them to listen to those and hopefully to contribute to that broader debate.
One of the differences in America is the attachment to religion, to formal religion, and you really took the bull by the horns in that regard, didn't you, with many of your views and the issues that you've been interested in canvassing.
Well, certainly the views that I hold are ones which particularly conservative Christians, the fundamentalist Christians who are so numerous in America, are implacably opposed to. I mean, there are many liberal Christians who do not disagree with the kinds of things that I say. But particularly with President Bush in office and the Republicans in control of Congress, these conservatives were having enormous political sway and still are, really. And so the issues that I wanted to discuss, issues about the sanctity of life, about abortion, about stem cells, for example, but also my views about the killing of civilians in Iraq, which of course go towards protecting innocent human life, where the Bush administration was not very careful about protecting innocent human life. All of those things are very much opposed by the Christian right in America generally.
Well, did you enjoy being at the centre of controversy?
It's probably true that if I'd not written about the ethics of how we ought to handle babies born with severe disabilities, I would not have had that trouble when I came to Princeton. And, you know, some people in the animal movement say, oh, it's a pity that I get tarred with this brush because, you know, my views on animals would be more widely respected and accepted if that were not the case. But, you know, I can't do that. I mean, I've got to write about issues in the way that I believe is sound and justifiable and defensible. And I'm not a politician. I'm not in a popularity poll. I'm not going to change my views because that will avoid some flack or some opposition. So I think I've got to be true to my thinking.
Well, to what extent do you need tremendous self-belief to have the confidence to take positions on the things that you do?
I don't think I feel that the issues that I have, I need tremendous self-belief. I'm putting positions out there to be discussed. I know that there are other people who oppose these positions. I mean, it will vary what I'm talking about. You know, perhaps a lot of people support me about the need for people in the rich countries to do something about global poverty. Rather fewer support me about animal liberation or about, you know, maybe it's in the middle somewhere with issues about voluntary euthanasia and euthanasia for disabled newborns too. So, I'm putting these positions out there. They're going to be debated. I'm not making the law or anything like that. And I think what I say, I think about carefully. I find reasons for it. I think it's a position that's worth being stated. If it doesn't survive in the cauldron of debate, okay, so be it.
As you get older, how have you reflected on your own ego and what part that plays in all of this?
Well, I've realised that obviously it's very difficult to really act entirely on ethical principles, and I'm certainly not an example of that. I do fall short, and that makes me perhaps fairly tolerant about other people who fall short in the same ways or in different ways. You know, through my life, I've met lots of people. There's very, very few who I could really say are living a completely ethical life, because I think the truly ethical life is quite a demanding one.
Well, these days you divide your time between Princeton and Melbourne. Let's see how.
I've really enjoyed being at Princeton, but at the same time, Renato and I have missed Australia. We've particularly missed our family being here in Melbourne. So I was very pleased when the University of Melbourne offered me a laureate professorship, which enables me to spend 3 months, at least a year in Melbourne, with the Centre for Applied Philosophy and Public Ethics.
Most recently, Professor Singer published a book entitled The Ethics of What We Eat, but is here today to address issues regarding our obligations in relation to global poverty. it's obviously a popular one, having packed out two lecture theatres.
I've been writing about the question of global poverty and what the citizens of wealthy nations like ours owe to the poor since the 1970s. And I think it's one of the crucial issues that the world faces now. Now that we have so much affluence and we have a somewhat better understanding of how aid can be made more effective. A word on the size of the problem as a whole, the shortfall in income of the extremely poor is $124 billion a year. This is what the United States alone spends on alcohol each year, $116 billion. That's the US alone. Obviously, this should be made up by all of the wealthy countries, including ours, and that would still leave people in the US enough for a drink or two occasionally, and us as well, I guess. Sink or swim, sink or swim. When I'm not working, I like to get outside. So Renata and I like to go hiking. I've also always been keen on the beach, body surfing, bodyboard surfing, and more recently I've taken up surfing with a surfboard, and I've found that a lot of fun as well. I just love being out there in the waves. It's such a great feeling on a sunny day when the sky's blue and the sea's blue and the waves are crashing all around you. Water's fine from the edge, but how you gonna know if you don't get wet, don't get wet? I think that there's something really special about watching your children grow up and become parents themselves, and seeing the continuity of the next generation. So obviously we were delighted when our grandson Isaac was born, and it's one of the best things about coming back to Australia in, this year, that we've really been able to get to know him, and I've been able to spend time with him and do things with him. What's it gonna be when you die on it? So I included a recipe for dal in the first edition of Animal Liberation, because that came out in 1975 when there weren't very many vegetarians. You know, a lot of people didn't know what you would cook if you stopped eating meat. And then more recently, when I collected some of my writings that cover the key ideas of my thought, I thought it would be good to have that recipe in it as well. Very economical. The basic ingredient is red lentils, and it's very nutritious. I think it's really tasty. You serve it over rice, and in fact it's the staple food for hundreds of millions of people. About 10 minutes before it's ready, you put in a can of chopped tomatoes, and shortly before serving you put in some coconut cream, and you can also squeeze in a bit of lemon juice at the end.
Well, Peter, that looks pretty delicious.
That was good. It was a very short cut of the dinner on the plate, wasn't it?
It was enjoyed by all.
Yes.
What sort of place does emotion have in your life?
Well, sometimes our values are just emotionally based. You know, sometimes people will say, what do you think of something? What do you think of cloning, for example? And we react, oh, yuck, right? And that's kind of really an emotional response, because you haven't thought about it. You haven't said, well, what, you know, is there really a problem with cloning? What are the benefits? What are the cons? What are the costs? What harm could it do? And so on. And if you stop and think and say, well, I'm not just going to go with that yuck response. If you stop and think, I'm going to think about this issue for a while, and I'm going to try and work out really whether it will do harm or damage in the long run, or whether it will do more benefit. That's the kind of response that I would like to see.
What's coming for the world?
Oh, I don't have a crystal ball, really. I don't know. I'm very worried about climate change, that we may have got into a stage where it's really irreversible. That's the sort of the real downside. I do think we're going to be able to take more seriously the problem of global poverty, and I'm hopeful that we're actually, you know, in 20 years there will be fewer people living in really extreme poverty than there are today. I think we can do that if we really make a bit more effort. And I also hope that we'll develop generally a more expansive ethic that embraces the whole planet, everyone in it, and all of the non-human animals who we are now inflicting so much suffering on.
Peter, it's been great sharing this time with you.
Good, thanks. Bye.
Thanks for coming on Talking Heads. And that's Peter Singer. We'll be back with another program at the same time next week. In the meantime, you can look at our website at abc.net.au/talkingheads, and Peter's recipe for dal will be on the website. See you soon.
As the economic juggernaut that is China gathers pace, it's struggling to keep up with the social and political pressures that brings. So says the Observer's Will Hutton. Join us tomorrow on Radio National Breakfast from 6.